I'm shooting you. So what? Do you, have you just
done bad or something?
Yeah, we're gonna see what happens. The Grandstand is live. I'm your host, Scott Kerman, and I'm joined by my usual cohorts, the Professor, Russ Stevens, and Uncle Joe McLaughlin. Well, we have a great show tonight, so boys, let's get it started. So, you know, every day I walk in to the lovely and talented Adrienne in whatever room she's in, and of course, she looks at me lovingly, and I always say those special three words, I love you. Well, today I walked in that room, she gave me those eyes, and I said, Dante is back. And it's true. She was a little confused. She knows I love her, but I also love Dante Hightower. And we're just coming in the last few hours. Dante Hightower is back with the Patriots in a 4-year deal. And as fans, we couldn't be happier.
Yeah, amen. Right? Totally agree with that. Yeah, I mean, this is the guy who's basically made 2 Super Bowl saving plays in the last 3 years. I mean, so he's not only a great player week to week, but he's come up big in the biggest games.
Hey, he's been my favorite player, save that second season, which we forget about. Right. He had a lot of troubles. His first year with the green dot. But every other year, he's been my favorite player on the team.
He's a defensive leader, right? We would say that unquestionably. Is he the second most valuable player on the Patriots?
Yeah, I mean, he's got to be right there in the conversation. I mean, we won a Super Bowl without Gronk last year. I would have said Gronk,
right,
in front of him, but that proved out not to be true. He's right there. Yeah.
And then, look, he signs.
But a distant second to TB12.
Right, of course, yeah. Brookline Zone. Yeah. But, and I don't know where Dante lives, but maybe, you know, now maybe that he's got the Brookline big cash, yeah, well, maybe a little Chestnut Hill home.
The A has become silent this week somehow.
Dante.
He was Dante for 4 years, and now all of a sudden, Dante. The fifth year, he's Dante.
Yeah. He's lucky he's not done tour here.
Right. Well, he's lucky he's not playing for the Jets.
Yeah, right. Yeah, right. Those cupcakes and right. Isn't that fitting? The team that's truly a cupcake.
Amateur
gives Dante
hour.
Gives
clown show down there. Absolutely. Classic. Well, if we give him enough cupcakes, he'll sign with us. But it doesn't matter that
we
stink.
Well, they offer him $2 million more per year.
Yeah, but
that's a lot of money. Yeah. I'd take an extra $2 million. Anyone wants to give it to me?
They don't mind being used. That's how pathetic they are, right? They knew that Dante wasn't going to ever sign with the Jets.
Just using them for leverage.
Yeah, right, exactly. So now all of a sudden we got Hightower in the fold, right? But it's been a remarkable transaction week this week. Can you remember, I don't even care about any sport, can you remember as many transactions for one of our teams in 1 week?
It goes back to Trader Danny's assemblage of the 2008 championship team.
No, but I'm talking about,
There was just a slew of transactions.
Every day, it seemed
bang,
like something
bang, bang,
else
bang.
Happened. Right.
And I can't remember, but this is double that.
Yeah.
Right.
You didn't want to take a shower, right? Because you're like, who did I miss? Who did we acquire?
When I got up, I went to the computer to see what they did overnight.
Yeah, just glued to Twitter, and it was coming hot and heavy from early on. I think it'll tail off now. But
okay, so before we talk about all the transactions, there's one elephant in the room, and that's Malcolm Butler. Malcolm has refused to sign his tender of close to $4 million.
Right.
And now apparently he's in New Orleans visiting with the Saints. So how do you think that ultimately unfolds?
It depends really if the Saints – I imagine that the Saints are ready to give Butler the contract that he wants. My guess is it's going to be more than what Belichick is going to pay. Mm-hmm. So it'll come down to can they come up with some sort of trade compensation. I think he's gone. I think it's going to be all about the trade compensation.
It all ends up being a wash. Brandon Cooks for Malcolm Butler is the eventual trade when in the draft picks all just get traded.
Doesn't it feel like they would have made that trade last week if they
had signed the tender? Yeah. They would have.
Yeah, but I don't think anyone would be happy with that deal. I mean, a quality defensive back is better than a quality wide receiver.
Granted.
You said, what do you think is going to happen? Yeah. I would rather have Butler play, but what I think is going to happen is I think he's gone.
But if the guy is unhappy and maybe not going to give you 100%, maybe you're better off taking the second best part of the deal, which is getting that.
Well, he's going to give you 100%, Joe, because he's going to be a free agent next year, so he's playing for
his
big dough.
He's got good
tape
no matter what, you know. He can, you know, just say it.
Yeah. My guess is that
Jamie Collins made up.
Given the fact that he's restricted, I don't think Belichick has any intention and never had any intention to pay him more than $7 or $8 million this year.
Yeah.
Right. And so if he comes back, if they come back with $11-12 million a year offer, I think he's going
to
be traded.
But the difference was Belichick was willing to pay him $7 million last year,
right,
and $7 million this year,
which would have
when
added
he only
up.
Would have made four and a half total.
Yeah, that's how they were looking at it. It's almost like buying a year of his free agency back is what they wanted.
But he didn't
want to
go for that.
Well, look, if the Patriots were that happy with a defensive backfield, instead of signing Gilmore, they could have signed Ryan and Butler.
But remember,
they could have used that money. So they clearly saw the tape, they reviewed the whole season, and they wanted to make some changes, and this is what happened.
I think that's my biggest takeaway from this is I think Belichick was taking a look at the way he wants to play defense over this year and next year and maybe the year after that. Maybe taking a look at the wide receivers and quarterbacks they're playing and saying, we need to get back to playing man-to-man defense. And I cannot play man-to-man defense with a bunch of 5'10" quarterbacks.
Yep, right.
I want to play press coverage because we were saying it last year. When they played press coverage last year, they played a much better brand of defensive football. And I think he saw that.
Yeah, because that zone ends up being a prevent defense, and we know how well that works
and
out.
Also, remember, the last time this kind of thing happened, remember, we got rid of Revis, Browner, and even though, thank God, Kyle Arrington, all in one offseason.
We got better.
We ended up winning the Super Bowl that year.
So there's a version of this, by the way, where he took a look at Gilmore and said, he's better. We like him better than Butler. He's a year younger than Butler, right? He gives us more flexibility on defense. That's the kind of guy we'll pay $13 million a year for.
Yeah.
And that may be it. He may have said, I'm choosing Gilmore over Butler.
So if the Patriots end up, we'll say, getting a first and a third round pick, which is reasonable, my prediction is for the third round pick, they will pick Sidney Jones out of the University of Washington, who just blew out his ACL this week in his pro day.
We can wait a year.
So
and he was a top 10, right, because the Patriots are the only team in the NFL that can redshirt guys.
Well, when you have a head coach who has a lifetime appointment, he can get away with redshirting guys.
Right. And that's even greater advantage now. You know.
And what about bringing back, all the charges were dismissed today, Mr. Revis.
Oh, that's been speculated,
right. He's getting $6 million. Guaranteed from the Jets, the board Jets will be paying him to play for us,
because
which would make it all the more delicious.
No, it's a great point, but is he more of a slot guy now at this point?
If he loses 30 pounds.
The scouts say he hasn't lost any speed. What he has lost is that ability to mirror.
Right.
So maybe play him at safety instead, where you don't, it's more read and react to safety. You're not mirroring like a cornerback has to. Play him at safety more.
Well, obviously, he would have limited snaps. He wouldn't be the Revis that's playing. You know, he's not leaving the field.
Yeah.
But, yeah, obviously, that would be
a
good pickup.
So you think Butler's – what you think will happen? Do you think he's gone or you think he'll come back?
I think Butler's gone, unfortunately. But I think that the Patriots – I know you guys think that with the relationship with Sean Payton that, you know, they're going to cut a sweet deal for each other. I think that the Patriots will play hardball, and the Patriots are going to want equal return.
Oh, I that I believe.
They own everyone
believe.
In the deal now.
I don't think they care, Joe, about the Brandon Cooks deal. That was last week.
They have him now.
Oh, it's a done deal. I think that's
He's
off the table.
He's under their contract now.
Yeah, that's off the table.
Because they have the advantage.
Right.
They're sitting there with four aces, okay?
Yeah.
They're not just going to hand it over.
Right.
Yeah. But, look, Belichick is literally scoring an A+, right, for the offseason.
Yeah, I give him an A- until he figures out this whole Butler scenario. I give him an A+. If he gets Butler, if Butler ends up playing at the tender next year, I think it's an A+ offseason.
Yeah, right. But I've never seen so much excitement for the Patriots in March, right? We're ready to tee it up.
Oh, 6 months before the season. Let's go.
It just goes to show you that when he had this kind of cap space, I mean, he's never had this kind of cap space, he's willing to do stuff with it.
Right. So We had Don Banks on last week, and he was great
he
and
was
fantastic.
Terrific.
And we didn't really talk about the Stephen Gilmore deal. Kind of an overpay, it looks like, right?
Yeah, may have needed
the market always is.
Oh, well, and I think that's right. You may have needed to do that to get that to me was the key to this whole thing. Like, he knew he needed to get that guy before he really got out on the market. And if he had to overpay a little bit for him, because that set all the other dominoes off.
And he's a guy they're familiar with. They obviously play him twice a year. Yeah. And it is addition by subtraction too. You take a guy off one of your division, you know, foes, right?
Sure.
And those guys are tough to replace.
They're going to have a terrible defense this year, it seems.
Who, Buffalo?
Yeah.
Also,
they're in rebuild mode again for the 100th time.
So Brandon Cooks, Saints fans, and I have a couple of friends who are Saints fans, are outraged. We're talking about, other than Drew Brees, the most popular guy on the New Orleans Saints, and they give him away for not a lot, right?
It's amazing.
32nd pick.
Yeah.
Is this guy maybe have an attitude? Why would the Saints do that?
My guess is he had carried himself and wanted to be paid, you know, ultimately like a number one receiver. They had a young guy, a rookie last year, emerge, Michael Thomas, as their number one receiver. And I think they probably took a look at it and said, we're not treating this guy like a number one receiver. He's our number two receiver. And if he's going to be a pain in the neck about
problem down the road,
we need to rebuild our defense. So we need as many assets as we can.
But aren't all wide receivers divas?
They're all divas, right?
To
they might have said, look, what we can afford to trade for defense is him. Because we got enough receivers.
And I guess the Danny Amendola era is probably over, right? I mean,
probably.
You got to think that pushes him out.
No, I think they put him on PUP for 6 weeks and then
do the same thing.
So for nine weeks, if someone gets hurt, then they
such a clutch
player. Put him
What's amazing,
in.
Though, is I was thinking about this the other day, to the team that scored the most points in the NFL and scored 30-some-odd points in the in the Super Bowl, we're adding Gronkowski and Brandon Cooks to that same team.
Right, exactly. And you know we're going to nurse Gronkowski, though we were nursing him last year as much as possible, and that didn't work out.
Him and Amendola will be on pitch counts.
Yeah.
Right.
They have to be. Deion Lewis, again, will be on a pitch count type thing.
And now that you have Allen and you'll get, you know, whatever that, you don't have to have Gronkowski in any special teams anymore blocking. You can't hide him. Remember, that's one of the times he got hurt was on special teams.
He has a broken arm.
And the other guy I predict they'll take in the draft is Jake Butt. For his name alone is worth a third round pick. But
haven't we lost another guy. Mingo?
He's got to be an offensive lineman.
No, he's a tight end. He's a big, fast. He's the Gronk of the University of Michigan. Injured this year, big kid, catches the ball. That's the kind of red shirt kind of guy that
yeah, we'll have one IR his first day of training camp. Right.
But understand the Patriots, we didn't have a first round pick last year. Okay.
Right.
We took a second-round pick. Cyrus Jones may have been the worst player in the NFL last year, right?
Pound for pound.
Right. Yeah. So, but when we start talking about the third and fourth and fifth and sixth rounds, that's where we got Thuny. That's where we got Malcolm Mitchell. That's where we got a Landon Roberts. Yep. And it was a great draft. So sitting as we are right now, those are kind of the same picks that we have left. Yeah. And, so we could get guys that could contribute to the team this year.
Absolutely. Always does. And off of free agency.
Right. So, all right. So it wasn't enough that, you know, I think a day had gone by that we hadn't made a transaction. So we get Burkhead from the Cincinnati Bengals. And a guy that actually, was it a Monday night game or a Sunday night game?
He went off late in the year,
Against the Ravens, who were the best rushing defense in the NFL. He had 120 yards.
So you get one of the top special teams players in football. And you get a guy that he can rush 10, 15 times, catch out of the backfield block. I mean, you just little pieces, right? This is just role players right now.
He led the Bengals in special teams tackles, too.
I think they'll, and my guess is, given this, that makes it more likely they bring Blunt back for $1 million, you know, basically the minimum, and have him earn some stuff on incentives again.
And they just tell LeGarrette, hey, this kid's younger. That's why he's getting three times as much.
I mean, Blunt is with the program. You don't have to convince Blunt. Yeah. Like, if he wants to be here and he wants to take $1 million again plus incentives, why wouldn't you do that?
Well for Blunt, I mean, that's going to be the only guy with team that offers a contract.
And I bet you Blunt got $1 million
in incentives. I think he made a bunch of money in incentives. Yeah, he might end up earning like $4 or $5 million last year.
But yeah, I bet 18 you doubled touchdowns. His money.
Yeah, and if Blunt stays local, he can do, you know, appearances to up the yin yang for the next 20 years.
He's going to Celtics games. All those free Celtics tickets.
He definitely likes
that. He's the Celtics number one fan. I got no issue with LeGarrette Blunt.
Yeah. Gets Isaiah Thomas's jersey every night, puts it on eBay, makes some money. Yeah, Blunt knows what he's doing. All right, so before we leave the Patriots, what going into the draft, and we'll have, of course, an NFL draft show as we do with the Grandstanders, what's the Patriots' biggest need?
Oh, I think right now it's two. It's offensive line, offensive line, offensive. I mean, you need depth tackles, in that offensive tackles. Line. You just need depth. Right. And we still need to fill out that linebacker core. And he'll do both of those, right?
Yeah, Dont'a Hightower, notwithstanding, they need linebacker depth. Yeah. Quality linebacker depth. You know, Freeney.
Freeney.
You know, these guys, Landon Roberts. These guys are not regular guys.
Yeah, I don't want to see McClellan on the team next year.
Not so much. I think they got good interior offensive line depth. They need tackles. All they got is Sauter and Cannon. After that, there's nothing.
Yeah, right. Ladrian Waddle is more of a guard hybrid kind of guy.
Cam Fleming is more tight end.
It's pretty bleak. He knows he's not getting – I think they had more snaps. Other than Atlanta, they had more snaps out of that starting offensive line than any team in football.
And starting left tackles, you got to get them in the top 10 of the draft, seems. Those guys are valuable.
And they get
no
paid.
No one lets them go. Then they sign them to seven-year contracts afterwards.
Right. Yeah. All right, so we'll leave the Patriots for now, but wow. It's all right. It's
Last one.
What?
Jimmy G.
Okay.
So he's here, right?
For good.
Jimmy G's here for good.
I think he's here for good. If they roll that money over, if they take that $10 to $15 million of cap money and roll it into next year, that's a sign they're going to franchise Jimmy G and they're going to keep him around as long as they possibly can.
Yeah, that's a great point. And also the whole premise is that if we're all in again for next year and something happens to Tom Brady, everybody believes they can win a Super Bowl with Jimmy G. But not with Jacoby Brissett.
No, not yet.
No.
Who knows? Yeah, maybe down the line.
Yeah, but you know, we're going for it again.
He's buying insurance with Jimmy G. He's buying the insurance this year for a low cost. He may have to pay a lot of money to buy insurance next year for Brady.
But also, we don't have glaring needs that you need to collect all these draft picks and stuff to get to.
That's the idea of the busy offseason. Then everyone you get in the draft is – luxuries.
Which, by the way, I think makes it even more likely that Butler gets dealt because if they keep Butler, they're going to want the option to franchise him and trade him. And if they have Jimmy G in mind, they're going to want to preserve that franchise.
Yeah, you can only have one franchise player.
Yeah. Right. And they need the space. So Jimmy G's here, but you never know. We'll keep on talking about it because when you have GMs like John Lynch – in the San Francisco 49ers.
Anything's possible.
Anything's possible. That could be like a Ricky Williams deal where he gives us the whole draft. You know?
That's right.
So, all right, we go to the Red Sox, and our beloved Red Sox, I know if you look outside, it doesn't seem like the Red Sox are going to start in less than 3 weeks, April 3rd, against the Pirates at home. And one Rick Porcello was announced today as the opening day starter.
He should be.
Yeah, we're not surprised by that, right?
Yeah, he earned it last year, won the Cy Young, gamer, emotional guy. He's everything you want at this point.
But I was surprised that Farrell said that Chris Sale had been moved up to number two because of David Price's injury.
That just seems stroking that ultimate poster child for millennial athletes, David Price.
Situation,
right? I mean, can we stroke David Price on a daily basis? Because I think that he's a guy. Speaking of Ricky Williams, I think he's a guy that the way he talks could walk away from baseball in like a moment and start living in the woods.
The bigger question will be.
I mean, he's got some issues.
He's going to have his own. He's going to. Yeah, it's going to be up to him whether he stays or goes. Right.
Yeah.
He's got an option after next year. $30 million, and if he really wants out, he's gonna have a wide open opportunity. We'll see how much David Price wants to bet on himself at the end of next year.
And will the Red Sox be secretly happy if he opts out?
They will be thrilled. Yeah, are you kidding me?
They really didn't want to sign him anyways, but they kind of have
look. The thing about Price is, in a way, he has proven John Henry and Ben Cherington right.
Yeah, about the 30-year-old.
Right? They've been saying, and we said, oh, you gotta get rid of that. You gotta get rid of that. That's a dumb rule. You know, that's just. And then they did it, and now we've got a guy on the verge of getting a Tommy John surgery.
But isn't it crazy? Because opening day is really not going to be the most exciting day of that week. It's going to be game two with Chris Sale.
For sure.
Usually that's a game where you're lucky. It's going to be 27 degrees out, and you have about 12,000 in the park.
He looked filthy the other day.
Yeah.
Boy, I watched a lot of that game, and he just pounds it.
He's the kind of guy in these great pitchers that if you don't get him early, he may give up a run or two, but then he'll knock off five innings in a heartbeat.
It reminds me of Jim Palmer. He just kills you that way.
Yeah, he's that good.
If you don't get him in the first inning, you're done.
He's going to end up being the most popular player on the Red Sox. That's going to be Pedro must-see TV when Chris Sale pitches.
Keep the scissors away from him.
Yeah, no, but look. You know,
no sharp objects in the clubhouse.
Look, if you've ever have you ever been to White Sox Stadium and know what that area in Chicago is, you need to carry scissors is just the beginning of what you need to carry in that town. So I understand that's all over with. Chris Sale's our guy, and he's all Boston. Like
he says all the right things. All the right things. And he throws inside. He's going to hit 20 guys this year.
Yeah. And and he's going to be pissed off.
Pedro all over again.
Yeah.
I love pitchers, and that's why, you know, of course, I love John Lester. I love when they're – and Beckett, when he was great, pissed off, leaving the mound, even when they don't even give up a run.
How bad does – boy, how bad does the Lucchino-Charrington decision on John Lester look? It gets worse every year.
Oh, yeah, doesn't it, though?
It gets worse every year.
Yeah.
Here's a guy wins a World Series last year for the Cubs, takes the ball every fifth day, throws inside, says all the right things, cancer survivor, and they let this guy walk in favor of signing David Price. And they put them in a position where they had to sign David Price.
But then they also put money in towards Sandoval and Ramirez, too, to try to make up.
It set a chain of events off that just – it's still astounding.
But at the very least, they paid for it. Larry Lucchino is sitting there in somewhere in Rhode Island, can't even get a stadium.
I believe that's the thing that ushered him out. Yeah. I really do believe that that was
and
it.
And Betty is – without a job, as far as
I know. No, I thought he's a consultant with Toronto or something. Yeah, but he's not the GM of the Boston Red Sox.
No.
And for a guy who won in 2013, he was out the door pretty quick after that.
So, question for you. Yeah. Do you think Price will win 13 games this year?
Yes, I think he will.
I do, too. I think he's 13 to 15. He'll probably pitch better than he did last year if he's healthy.
He pitched terrible last year, and he had wins.
Yeah, he wins games because
Gives you innings.
He throws strikeouts.
He gets to the eighth inning even though he's given up six runs.
Yeah, and he had a great offense behind him last year. I think he wins 13 to 15.
And then just this breaking news in. Stephen Wright ate breakfast today, and I found out he did not get hurt during it.
He didn't hurt, nothing.
He's all set. But it just shows you, two of our five of the starting rotation really are millennial. At least two.
Eduardo's cupcakes, right there. By the way, Rodriguez is right there with him.
Yeah.
If the shrink doesn't go on the road with him, you never know what'll happen.
Right. I mean, we've got like frail guys who could go at any second.
Yeah.
Now the name escapes. The guy from Arizona there, he looks
Pomeranz.
You know. Yeah.
He's
another
one.
We're going to have plenty to talk about when it comes to the starting pitching staff this year.
Yeah. But we have a big problem because we have. Russ, we have no depth in the minor leagues.
Though, how many teams have seven starters? Like, that's over. You know, the depth doesn't match the quality at the top of the rotation.
We have six, but we definitely don't have.
No, but we have
Henry Owens.
But we don't have any young guys in the minor leagues that we can bring up. How many starts is Henry Owens going to have?
No, they're not. I'm sure they're looking at Brian Johnson. This kid Kyle Kendricks has pitched well. No team has eight great starters, though.
It
looks bad in comparison because there's such a drop off.
And also, we have frail guys. I mean, we're supposed to, our horse is a little pony.
Yeah.
Coochie. My God. Some of the things that he said is actually kind of disturbing for him, his mental state. You know, that you really don't express that to people.
He's going to need to toughen up this year.
Yeah, he needs a girlfriend.
Yeah.
Big time. Yeah. And a goldfish and a dog.
He's got a dog already. That's the problem.
He's got a dog. He didn't seem like the kind of guy that's got a dog.
He needs a girlfriend. Maybe two girlfriends. Yeah. All right. So I just want to remind you that Mitch Moreland's on the team, and he sucks. And don't even think
Because all the evidence and the facts support the fact that he's going
to
suck.
All you have to do is look at his statistics from last
year. Lifetime statistics aren't all that great.
Mitch Moreland is Brian Daubeck, and he's going to be in the starting lineup most of the season.
He's got to be faster than Daubeck, though.
Here's the thing.
That's true. Yeah.
First off, lefties in Fenway Park, if they are flexible and they know and they open their minds up to hitting the ball the other way in Fenway Park, can do quite well. And from the looks of him in spring training, when he's hitting basically 320, he looks like a guy who can hit the ball the other way.
Good lefties. Quality hitters.
Yeah,
quality left hitters. Wade Boggs.
Here's
the deal. Ted Williams.
You're looking
Mitch
for
Moreland.
What are you looking for? 300 quality at bats out of him against right-handed pitchers. My guess is he will surprise us at how productive he is in this lineup against righties. I'm not saying he's gonna hit 320, but I bet you the guy hits 280. Hits 12 home runs, drives in 55 runs with that limited at bats. We're not saying he's going to hit 25 home runs.
Okay,
that's
he'll
what you
play
need.
Right, so we're holding you to that.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah. Put it on the board.
I buy it.
Put it on the board.
I'm buying.
285, 10 to 12 home runs, 50 RBIs.
I'm buying.
He's Daniel Nava times two. And you watch. Okay. He's going to come up in every clutch situation humanly possible from inning seven through nine.
Mark it down, Joe. 285, 10 to 12 home runs, 50-ish RBIs.
No.
Right? We'll see where
that goes. I'm buying.
Sam Travis.
Maybe not the 285.
Mitch Moreland will be again with Rusty Castillo and Alan Craig in Pawtucket by May 15th. And Sam Travis will be the starting
May
first 15th. Baseman.
Yeah, so May 15th. 6 weeks from now. Is he going to go for 0 for 30 or something? Like, what planet is Mitch Moreland going to get sent back down
because
May 15th?
Because in the opposite field, it's that he's going to get so
it's
much
like
on Fenway
David
Park.
Price was going to be traded by July 1st last year.
Yeah. Oh, don't you wish he had?
Yeah. Might have been better if he had.
Yeah, right. You guys laughed.
But then he was your favorite come the playoff time, and he sucked.
You had a prediction about the current president in July 1st a few days ago that made me remind you that you had David Price traded by July 1st.
All right. Well, needless to say, you watch.
And from your mouth to God's ears, by the way.
We have more trouble because the Mitch Moreland of relief pitching is Craig Kimbrell. And it's official. That was a terrible deal. And he's a mental midget.
That deal looks worse by the week at this point in time.
Yeah.
He just does not inspire any confidence whatsoever. He'll grab the ball, right? You know, he overthrows it, yanks the ball on his fastball. He's yanking fastballs into the dirt at 98 miles an hour. That's not good.
Everybody has figured him out in both leagues. Right? This is a guy that he can't throw his fastball over, and he loves his off-speed pitch, right?
You sit on it.
And the whole game of baseball, pitching-wise, is fastball command.
Yeah.
And if you do not have command over your fastball, it doesn't matter how hard you throw it or what your secondary pitches are.
You can't set
you're
him
done.
Up.
Okay, so would you not be surprised by that May 15th date again, that Joe Kelly is the closer by May 15th?
He blows three saves early in the year, and Farrell will start tinkering.
Especially if he blows them, you know how, and Farrell is using him the way he has to be used. Clean.
That's right.
Ninth inning, no one on base, you know.
You'll see.
All those.
Because Farrell, Farrell's Achilles heel, of course, is his in-game management in specifically the bullpen. So Farrell knows that he's going to be managing for his job this year,
right,
based on how well because he's going to be writing names into the starting pitching lineup.
Last year it was the eighth inning problem because he had no one to pitch that.
So he's not going down with Craig Kimbrell. You can bet your life that Farrell knows. He's saying, I'm not going down with that guy.
Yeah, and nothing's more demoralizing to a team that is winning the game the whole game, and all of a sudden your closer comes in the ninth. Everyone thinks they're going to get ready to eat the buffet, and he blows the lead and blows the game.
He walks the first couple
of
times.
So you think it's Joe Kelly would be the backup?
Joe Kelly, because apparently Thornburg
God.
We don't have a lot of rocket scientists on the Red Sox.
Worse than that, the Red Sox gave him a list of things to do with his shoulder over the course of the winter, and he didn't think to confirm that it was daily and that you're supposed to do all of them as opposed to like a menu. Like, I'll do this today and I'll do this one next Thursday. So Thornburg admitted he didn't do the exercises every day that the Red Sox, and instead of calling John Farrell or his pitching coach and say, hey, I have a problem here, I need to clarify something, he goes into spring training with a weak arm.
But that just shows you how stupid he is that he admit.
Oh.
Yeah. Right? Wouldn't you keep that to yourself?
You can't. This guy's going to be a problem. This could have Carson Smith written all over it. He looks like the 2017 version of Carson Smith.
Yeah, and we just better hope that Andrew Benintendi, now they're talking about Andrew Benintendi batting third, absolutely, I'm all in for, right? Because I want my quality top players getting as many of his
at-bats. It's going to cost
Mookie
some at-bats. So that's the one downside, because Mookie batting fifth is going to lose 20, 30 at-bats.
He bat fourth. Then you put Hanley fifth.
Hanley?
Yeah.
I think they've got Hanley lined up as the fourth hitter. But even still, it's going to cost Mookie at-bats if you move him down the lineup.
Yeah.
That's the bottom line.
I kind of really like Mookie in that third spot.
I know. Well, you know, but we'll see. I mean, it'll obviously depend
nice,
on
these
on
are in
who
the
plays.
Category of nice problems.
Nice problems,
have.
Exactly.
Absolutely. Right. Well, we have a lot of good problems right now, and it's a good time, of course, to be a Boston sports fan. But that's our show for you tonight. Of course, I want to thank the boys. I want to thank the lovely and talented Adrian. Please check us out on our website at thegrandstanders.com, and tune in again next Wednesday night at 6:30 for another edition of Grandstanders Live. I'm your host, Scott Kerman. Have a great and happy night.
Hello.
edition of Grandstanders Live.
It's off now.
Hello, and welcome to another edition of Grandstanders Live.
No, the show's off.
Yeah, the show's off.
Russ, that was, I think, your finest show. Fun. You were killing it tonight, wasn't he?
Excellent. Excellent.
He was all over everything.
Of course he's all, but I think you're always excellent.
No.
So, yeah, I wouldn't, you know,
most
he,
nights
was,
I he was especially good.
Is that right? You were.
That was fun.
Excellent show, yeah. Guys. Excellent.
That was fun.